And I am super, super happy and honored to be introducing Mary Kelly, who is one of those people who doesn't really need introduction, but nonetheless, we tried. I'm going to give a very brief introduction, because there's so much there, it's hard to know what to say. This is a person who is foundational to contemporary feminist art and has been since the early 1970s, and continues to make extremely rigorous and relevant work to the present day and onward. She has 3 major galleries. She has a show opening this Saturday at Suzanne Fielmeter, and she's still stuck to her commitment to come and talk to us. So we're especially honored about that. So very briefly, Mary Kelly is known for her project-based work addressing questions of sexuality, identity, and historical memory in the form of large-scale narrative installations. She's worked in, she was in London from the late 60s through the 1970s. As many of you know, that was an epic period in the formation of feminist art discourse, and she was at the center of some of that formation. She became, she produced collaborative works such as Night Cleaners, 1970-75, and the installation Women and Work, a document on the division of labor and industry, 1975, and again, so prescient for all of the current work being done on the question of labor and labor and gender, as well as producing her iconic work on the mother-child relationship, Postpartum Document, which was completed in 1979. In 1989, she joined the faculty of the Independent Study Program at the Whitney Museum of American Art in New York. Again, became a key figure at a key moment in a formation of a critical mode of thinking about the visual arts that merged theory and practice. While in New York, she also produced major and influential feminist installation works, including Interim, which was completed in 1989, Gloria Patri in 1992, and Mea Culpa in 1999. Moving to Los Angeles to teach at UCLA, again, Mary became central to an incredibly interesting group of people changing the way we think about art making, but also about art pedagogy, continuing her role, again, as a hugely influential teacher and mentor, as well as creator of key feminist works. The Ballad of Kastriat Rezhepi was produced in 2001, Love Songs 2005-07. Since 1996 then, she's been professor of art and critical theory in the School of Art and Architecture at UCLA. So I'm just going to leave it to you at this point, Mary. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for the introduction. As you can see, it's very long, and I'm not going to give you the whole life story, but just a few key works that might say something about my process that could be interesting to you. It's Amelia that could make me do anything. Even if I was in the middle of an installation, I would do anything from you. And you know how lucky you are to have her, I'm sure. Yes. So, with that, could we have less light and more image? Mm-hmm. So I'm going to begin with the Postpartum Document, although Amelia mentioned the Night Cleaners and Women in Work that I had been involved in before this project, which began in 1973. But actually, I was trained as a painter. I studied in Florence, and I lived for a short time in Beirut. And I came to London in 1968, when everything was changing. And at St. Martin's School of Art, there was a sort of group of artists that were working at that time, like Richard Long, Gilbert and George and others, and conceptual work was what I really was interested in. So first I did work that was very systematic, and it was with all the kind of social movements of the time that many of us were kind of drawn to film. Film is the kind of inherently progressive media, which we now know is not the case. But at that time, it had a tremendous influence on the way that I worked, and I spent really quite a few years working on the film Night Cleaners and thinking through like ways of approaching documentary differently. And also that led me to work on an installation in a similar way to film. Some of you who are film buffs here, you might know that some experimental filmmakers of that period, we used to see films like every day, practically all day long. Everyone was a cinephile in those days. And two filmmakers in particular that worked together, Straub and Huye, they're famous for Anna Magdalena Bach, and another one, perhaps you don't know, called Othon, was an epiphany for me. I saw this long tracking shot into Rome where they let the reel go all the way. In those days when you had like a 16 mil camera, it took about 10 minutes for the whole reel to run. So that notion of real time for me was so compelling. Now, in the shot that you see here, the long view of postpartum document, the installation at the Generali Foundation in 1998 when they brought it all together again. I always say, this is a typical Mary Kelly image. You can't see anything. And one of the things that interested me against the sort of gestalt idea that had come from minimalism, of taking something in the glass, that it would be something dispersed kind of slowly in space and kind of recollected after. So there's an intimate connection to the reader, viewer in the space that took me from perhaps conceptual artists' use of duration to something that was more like cinematic duration or diegetic space, because there was a narrative that was unfolding, you know, over time. Now, it was also important that at that time, in terms of the so-called dematerialization of the art object, you know, the question of medium as it was posed by Rosalind Krauss and others, but primarily by Krauss, insisting that we think of it as a physical support, but also a technical one, that whatever, say, you were doing photography, what that medium would demand is a certain set of procedures. So for me at that time, there were a number of questions that were posed within the field of conceptualism that needed to be addressed. And one of these had to do with, well, what if you thought of the physical support differently? What if it now could be considered as a site, a physical site, a location, even a community, even an oppositional movement? What if that was a support, then what were the rules? What were the procedures? And that's how I came to talk about first the debate-specific site or the discursive site. It's like where the origin of the question that drives a procedure comes from. And for me, of course, that leads us to the social movements of the time, primarily the women's movement, which is where I found the location, if you like, for those questions. In the postpartum document, which I began, as I said, in 73, it's divided into six sections, and it has 135 small works in it. It started out perhaps more intuitively than any of you would think, since I became notorious for kind of overworking something. Mm-hmm. And it really was a matter of having thought about the process of labor, specifically women's work, but in the context of debates at the time about domestic labor. And there were many of us who thought that what we call like the sexual, social division of labor wasn't just as simple as, say, paying women for housework or something. It had to do with the deeply unconscious way in which women were connected to an idea about femininity as maternal. So I thought after doing the Night Cleaners film and the Women in Work project, which looked at transformations in the labor process during the implementation of equal pay, I thought I would look more closely at what was done in the home because of what I found in those projects. Most of the women, say, at the factory, didn't say anything at all about what they did at work, where all the men would tell me all about the machines and things they operated, and the women would just say everything they did at home. They were connected only to that kind of domain. So I was interested to know what was the kind of subjective moment, if you want, of women's oppression, and also very differently how we construct notions of femininity. And the maternal was just one of them. But it was deceptive because in a way it let the woman play out the role of the socially acceptable position, but be actually in a place that has a certain control over the object, a certain relation to desire that's satisfying. And in order to see what's pleasurable or satisfying in that relationship was absolutely crucial to understanding why it couldn't be oversimplified in that sense. So here, these are these very tiny little vests that an infant wears. And when you're taking care of them, you're folding these clothes up, and it just seemed to me at that moment of folding and unfolding these small garments that there was something that mapped itself onto the Lacanian schema of the unfolding of the subject in the field of the other. It was the kind of aha moment that where I thought, well, you know, it's nothing to do with child development. It's not just the child's kind of entry into language and culture. It's a complete transformation and duplication almost of that process on the side of the mother. So just writing or just taking the pencil and putting these schemas on the vests was something that I started with and then systematically moved into the other sections of the document, which I'll try to review as briefly as possible. But just to give you some sense of how duration, for example, gets transformed in this procedure into something like diegetic space. You have here a line of stained diaper liners. Everyone's way, way too young to remember that there was a period where without disposable diapers. And so they used to put liners in. And so there were the stains left on the liners were juxtaposed with the feeding charts that showed everything that I was feeding my son every hour of the day, just at the crucial moment when I was introducing solid food. So, you know, the thing about breastfeeding is that it continues that very symbiotic relation, but there is a moment when the child does have to eat something else, right? And that intervention becomes very symbolic, or it becomes a moment of separation. And those were the things that triggered off the sections of the document the things I intuitively felt were moments of loss, like what's going on here? It isn't just one catastrophic event where the child grows up and leaves home, but there are little increments, all these increments. So in the first section of the document, the question really was always, well, what have I done wrong? Because if the child has diarrhea or constipation, how does that cut across the idea that you're supposed to be the good enough mother, right? I said, what have you done wrong? So the way that it's kind of internalized makes the liner in some sense symptomatic of the mother's desire to maintain that particular relation to the child's body where she is actually sufficient. And in the second section, though, which has to do with the beginnings of speech, you can, in this view, get an idea that each section sort of set out trying to mimic a certain empirical science with, you know, tongue in cheek. You know, it's like how that works, but not at all, right? So a linguist might say, a child's single utterance is conceptually complete, right? But that gave me a kind of insight into why it was that you had something not as visible as weaning from the breast, but just as dramatic in the way the mother was connected to what the child uttered. It's like she almost provided the signifier for a signifier. Nobody but the mom knows what the heck they're saying, right? But then something even more interesting happened later, which is he started to use a nonsense word, and I had no idea what was going on. So then there was another question. Well, why don't I understand it? And just talking with other women, I realized, okay, this seems to be the case, that it happens for everybody. They don't know what they're talking about. So what they do is they use what's called a pivot, a little nonsense word in combination with another one, another, well, you can call it a word, but another utterance. And what that shows is that they have the propensity to speak grammatically. So, again, a moment of independence, right? A moment of separation. And something that, and again, it's not as though I knew what I was looking for. I was kind of moving intuitively with the feeling of loss, right? And doing the documents, perhaps to start with, and then in the way that a pediatrician would ask you to provide that information. But on this one, I got very carried away with the rigor of setting it out with the event structure. I'll show you that. The way a linguist would. And in fact, I did such a good job, they used it at University of Chicago to show the mother's role in the acquisition of language. But as I say, it's not as though I set out from that point of view. And also, I was interested in the kind of visualization of that material, which is why I think it's always rather difficult to get my work if you don't see it, because this stuff is so important in conveying the affect. So I set the words out in type, and then they have to be printed to be read. But I know that there were like critics like Benjamin Buklow in the early days who said, oh, the theory's great, but why do you have to have that stuff in it? So I knew I was on the right track. Because this brings me to the second question that I had, question, debate with conceptualism at the time. And that's, if first you interrogate the object and then you interrogate the interrogation itself, then you've got to go to that place which is to ask about the subjective investment in the work. There has to be a place to make that inquiry about subject formation. And it wasn't there in Art and Language and the people I admire at the time. And it just looked like a thing waiting to happen, like you must go there. But all my viewers in 1976 were divided. Like, there were people who identified with the experience and hated the theory and liked the theory and hated the experiential part of it or didn't like the materiality of it. So it was very controversial, you know, at the time. And I think that in terms of how you kind of look back on this period of 73 to 79, that was the beginning of perhaps a lot of things that have been identified with postmodernism later on, which is a conversation we could have later. But just to, are you okay with me moving through this? Okay. So three, you can actually recognize that it's in place of science here, you've got Leonardo's schemon perspective. But the perspective schema is this. It's over the drawings that were brought from preschool. You have in the first column, where it would be the object to be drawn, you have the tape recorded conversations. And then you have the playback, as it were, in the second column. And then a week later, thinking about it and writing it down, the thoughts in a diary. So what you have here in perspective has to do with memory, or that's your vanishing point, as Lacan might describe it, as something which is what's the vanishing kind of real, meaning what's real for the subject. Now, if you want to carry this little analogy further, you could say the distance point in this psychological perspective schema has to do with the third term in the relationship. So that's what this work was about, was a reference to the father, to the father's name. Like I say in the little thing, like, I'll tell your father. Of course, the father had no demonstrable authority that anyone could recognize. But it's much more about the word and about the reference that the child understands that there's something that comes between him or herself and the first object. And as you know, classically, that's Freud's famous triangle, his Oedipal triangle. And it kind of takes us into the point of transgression, because that's actually how the child's unfolding desire manifests itself, is kind of across the demand that the mother makes. In four, there are eight of these, which, can you tell what these are? They're plaster imprints of his hand. They look a lot like things you made for your parents in kindergarten. And then they're little fragments of a comforter. And I typed on the comforter this kind of diary about going to work. People with children will recognize this. You know, you're getting anxious, you want to get back. There's this kind of sense of separation, which around the age of two is very intense. Because if some of you remember Freud's famous Fort Dagen, does that ring a bell? Where he says the child loves to throw something away and get you to bring it back, or play hide and seek. Because the most important thing at that first moment is to conceptualize absence, which is basically the absence of the mother. And it's then at what follows on that is to kind of establish difference, right? Which is fundamental to knowledge. But at this point, I was saying, oh my God, the mother is doing her own Fort Dagen. It's like, oh, you're so grown up on one hand, but no, you're still my baby, right? So I asked myself, really, what's at stake for her in this? You know, what is this point? And for people who are more theoretically interested in feminism, there was someone called Michel Montrelet, writing around the same time in 1977 about the proximity of the woman to her mother's, her own mother's body. It's a rather different relationship from the one that she has with the son. And it led me to think in this work that in having the child and being like your mother, you were kind of incestuously, pleasurably close to her. And that's kind of why a lot of women had another child right then, at that point, at the moment of separation that's around that time. So a lot of those kinds of issues that carry on, like in this piece, juxtaposing the things that he brought me with absurd questions like, I don't know what the one is up there, can you read it? But it's, some of them are like, do you have a hole in your tummy when he looks at a snail? Or, will the bad man come and cut off my willy? And it has nothing to do with the thing that's there. And so over time, this one was really hard to think, how am I going to visualize that? And I decided I would just juxtapose it with these fragments from a dictionary of full-term pregnancy and the terms that didn't really answer the question. And of course, you know, that's what Freud would maintain too. There's really no answer. The child's gonna figure out what side they're on, however screwed up that is. It doesn't matter which parent they identify with or how they figure it out, what their eventual object choice is. They just decide to construct difference, which is why you can be very frustrated with a young child of like 4 or 5 if they say, like he did at the end of this, he said, well, men's don't dance with men's, they dance with women's. Mm-hmm. And then all my feminist friends said, no, why aren't you telling him? No, that's not true. And I said, yeah, sure, try. And so they keep repeating that because it's a schema that they need. It could be inverted, but it's their schema and it's their passage to establishing difference. And of course, the child psychologist Piaget says children never ask questions about the order of the universe until they figure out sexuality. So obviously, if you thought about this from the mother's point of view, it was, oh, okay, what am I? I'm no longer, you know, the object that satisfies everything. I am now in my social place. In a sense, as Freud would think of the idea of castration, as symbolic, right? It's a kind of reinstatement in that order. And the last work has to do with writing. Writing for a child is not logical. There are like 15 letters in his alphabet, and they all have one purpose, which is to get to the point where he can write his name. And writing the name, he becomes really the author of his own text. So in the stories here, this one, I set all of these pieces out like the Rosetta Stone. That might be obvious to some of you, which was my kind of send-up of the museological moment, like have my little archaeology of everyday life situated in this way. So you'd have his letters where the hieroglyphics would be. You'd have the narrative that revolves around conversations from the children's books where the demotic would be. And then you have a diary where the Greek would be that speaks about starting school and how another institution actually enters into this relationship to take a place that was formerly kind of occupied by that one-to-one relationship. And there are many, for me, the questions that it kind of raised about well, what Marx might have called separation from the means of production, like how every woman has that same desire for her child to be what she wants it to be, but it's so circumscribed by its socioeconomic conditions. There's a lot of that that shows up in the narrative as you kind of read through the work. And I will not read to you long stories because you don't have enough time. to that right now. And I'll just kind of move on to give you just some idea about how this process of working from the discursive site to the strategies of the installation, which I came to call the narrativization of space, have evolved. And this is the shot from the Old New Museum in 1990, when my second project that I did in the 80s, between 1984 and 89, was shown in its entirety. This one had four parts, one related to the body called corpus, one in the middle called historia, and the one you see on the other side, pecunia, or money. And this probably had a kind of more Foucauldian overview, if you could call it that, in that I looked at the themes that I gleaned from lots of conversations. And it's not like I went out and interviewed people. It's just I take the stuff of everyday life again. I think of words like a medium. I think of what people say to me, the affect of it, the presence of the voice in the work, and how I kind of work with it. With the voice through the textual material as something of, you know, an idea of being a witness or almost an ethnographer of my own generation and of something that took place in the women's movement. So all these stories that I have from women in the movement. In the first work, the corpus piece, I used my clothes rather than myself, which raises, you'll probably all ask me the question about the image, right? Why don't I use images of women? And it's initially because this was something we felt we had to problematize, not because that was, you know, forever forbidden, right? But this was necessary at the time. So I had my own clothes photographed by professional photographer without me in them. And these kind of became the basis for rather stylized representations of the hysterics crisis. Because these positions, as you can see, open, twisted, folded, allowed me to think about not just one image, or one body, but a number of them, like filtered through different kind of reference. You know, it's not as though there's an essential body, as it were. It's always mediated by its representation, by its image, by the way that you internalize it. So in a close-up, you can see a little bit more closely. again, the process before light boxes. This is a transparency which is mounted on a plexi and painted on the back side of it. And you get the shadows as a result of the light that shines on it. And all of the, you know, the backdrops in the work have slightly different tones of pink, almost like a makeup chart. But it's I sort of thought of it as the English would say as tarting the work up, right? Because at the time, Laura Mulvey and I were accused of destroying pleasure by contesting the image. And I thought, well, how can you get some of the fun back into it without actually using the figurative image? And of course, that was in terms of the narratives. Now, again, I wrote in the first person indicative. It's very what you would think of as bloggish language, which didn't exist then. But, you know, women's magazine stuff, you know, so it's like not great writing, but fun to read type of thing, where she talks about, if you can see any of it there, about what to wear, right? And about the way that you imagine other women, she said. This woman imagines the other one to be very secure, right? That she her confidence must come from always feeling that she was attractive. And then that person says, well, she looks surprised, and she says, no one is that confident. I must admit that I've never missed an opportunity to glance in a mirror as I passed it, or in a shop window, or any reflective surface for that matter, hoping to catch a glimpse of myself as others see me. And then it ends with someone's, you know, it's a birthday party and they have a thing. But the key to kind of what comes through in the stories is something about that. As Lacan says, you do not see yourself from the place the other sees you. But also what's interesting in terms of his description of the unconscious too, is that it is not as internal as one might think. It has a kind of extant quality. That is, it's in the social world, because what makes up the unconscious is the effects of the speech of the other on you or on the subject, right? And so this kind of idea of the words and the talking cure, you know, in this piece, in the corpus piece, there's kind of a move, like from this, from looking to listening, and that kind of speed reading through it, the red, you know, a kind of way of working through. So the bottom line would be, to make a long story shorter, it's just, how could you position the woman as a spectator, or the man? It just, they would be in the position to occupy the place of the woman who sees the image and says, was I like that? Should I be like that? Was it, you know, I once like that? To kind of shift that anxiety to a kind of moment of laughter through the parody. It's the way that, as an insider, you can always send yourself up, right? In a certain way. And actually, the pleasure of that separation from precocious femininity, as I thought of it, was the aim. And I just show this very briefly, the Historia work, because it's connected to what I'm doing again now, is to take a more historical kind of overview of that period. And there's one image of a suffragette, for example, that this is set out in oxidized steel, and there's one screen print. It's like the galleys of newspapers. Again, something you won't know because that was before you were born. No disposable diapers. Galleys in real newspapers, right? No blog. So, here we are. But it kind of rolls on in a continuous story, which tries to understand, you know, just how different generations of feminism have made sense of something like the movement. And I come back to that in another work. But then I want to jump to the later work. Now, it was very interesting that in a kind of conference in London, I think at the end of the 90s, Amelia mentioned that I did a work called Mea Culpa, which was that had to do with war crimes, but mostly to do with women and children in relation to those atrocities. And I was talking about that, and Linda Nochland asked me what happened to feminism. And so I just bring this up as, like, how did my discursive site, what were the why did I go to war? Isn't war a feminist question? And it seemed absolutely necessary. Again, like I was saying in the beginning, how could you ask about the interrogation of interrogation without subject formation? I mean, how could you get to this point of talking about difference, about, and as I did in an earlier work, about masculinity and about the way that that ideology kind of drives the kind of what happens in times of war too, like the First Gulf War. that seemed to me something that needed to be understood, but it was so difficult to think how you could deal with it. And it took me a very, very long time to think of a certain way of kind of materializing this. Now, again, you can't see what you're looking at, but don't worry, I'll show you in a minute. But just to circle around the issue a little bit, to say there was also the question that if you're asking about sexual identity, what about questions of ethnicity and race that became very, very prominent, you know, kind of during the 90s? And what are the specific ways in which difference is inflected by these other things? So there was that. And you might, some of you remember that in the 90s, this is the time of the War Crimes Tribunal, right, the establishing of this, of a very urgent kind of human rights agenda. And in the academic world, the kind of discussion of ethics that came back in a very important way, which is something we could talk about again, but in particularly Agamben and Badu that then referred to this. So there was this, a kind of context. And this was also very prominent among feminists that were coming from the tendency that I was part of, that were engaged with psychoanalysis and Marxism when we started out trying to make sexuality pass into the big picture, as it were. So I was in the kitchen, and I like to have my studio at home and draw on stuff that happens there, which is very unusual these days with the big factory production of work and the million assistants, as you know. But I heard a woman speaking on television kind of at a distance from me, and it was during the Truth and Reconciliation Commission hearings in South Africa. And she was describing the way, the specific way that the police had executed the activists. And again, I mean, because lots of you are artists, you know how it's difficult to describe exactly what these moments are and how they manifest themselves visually. But it seemed that it's so connected to our everyday life. It's not something that's like far away, but it's in the newspapers, it's in television, it's in, there are certain residue of the traumatic events that are part of our lives. And if you, again, thought about it like Freud, saying that, you know, trauma is partly to do with a person's constitution in conjunction with with the accident or the tragedy, the kind of determinants, the traumatic effect, then there are ways in which you are much more connected than you know. And for me, the connection point was, again, with the mother and the relation to her child. Not because that I'm privileging that as the center of what happens in war crimes, but just kind of acknowledging that that was a subjective investment that got me there. So I was washing the clothes as well, and in the dryer, of course, I saw, and you've all noticed it, the gorgeous lint that's produced by the dryer. I think I might do something with that. And it was as though just the residue of the voice and the fragility and the ephemeral aspect, it seemed I had to use that medium to deal with this. There's something about the trauma and about memory that was, I thought this was the right thing. So here's a very close-up thing for you. And I'll tell you the more about the piece and the way. So what you saw in the long shot is 200 feet of this work, which is made up of lint panels, divided into four sections. And those four sections are stanzas of a ballad, which is called The Ballad of Castriot Rajepi from 2001, that was first performed at the Santa Monica Museum of Art, and then later in New York and Mexico City and in Spain. Now, In order to make the pieces, I use the filter screen of the dryer, right? So I put the text on in mirror reversal and you put it in the dryer. First do the whitewash and then do the black wash, right? Mm-hmm. And after 10,000 pounds of washing had been done, it ended up with that work. But just to go back to the installation a minute, do you remember the installation shadow postpartum document? Well, this is, for me, it's perfect because I got to have my whole 360 degree pan, and it's about 200 feet, the same as running the whole reel of film. And there you are, like it's a tracking shot. Now, the tracking shot is one where you don't read the thing all at once, it's kind of unfolding as you walk through it. And then there is another layer where it's performed, it's like, but first I'll tell you a little more about this, because I thought a lot has to be, I don't want to fetishize the material, it's like an assisted ready-made, but in fact I have to tell you that I thought I could find a shortcut to use things that would produce more lint, because it just started out with my clothes, mm-hmm. you know, the old, and lots of black and white and old and cotton, and I sort of went about things and they produced way too much fluff, and I realized I could only do it with my old clothes because it would produce the fine thing I needed. And a lot of other things that you need to do, like have the dryer on cool and use lime to, for separator. And so finally got it down to a process that could be managed. But in terms of the little fragment of text that you see there, not a word. This is what they said about the child, Castriot Rajepi, that he didn't speak a word. Now, to give you the background of the story for Castriot Rajepi, in 1999, this was the beginning of the NATO air war in Serbia and Kosovo, but specifically Kosovo. It led to the expulsion of the Kosovar Albanians from Serbia. And at the time, there was a story in the Los Angeles Times about a child that had been left by his parents for dead during this, when they were fleeing from the Serbs. And he was later discovered and brought back to his parents. But do you know, what was so incredible to me is that the child was 18 months. Remember, think of documentation 2. And it, just the beginning of life. So he didn't speak yet. He didn't speak. He was at that, absolutely at that moment where you're trying to internalize this image that you've set up in separation from another and an established difference. And at that moment, you have this confused ethnicity, which is mapped on. First, he's taken by the Serbs, and they give him a heroic Serbian name. And then later, when the NATO troops get there, he's abandoned again, and the Albanians find him, and they give him another name. I guess it was Lirim, that means freedom. And finally, when he is reunited with his parents, his first utterance is dad, or Bob, in Albanian. So you have this kind of incredible confluence of country, of patria, of the father's name, and of the moment of the entry into language and culture as a sexual subject, but also with this other inflection. And it sort of, for me, it kind of complicated the story of postpartum document because it kind of set it in circumstances where you realize it's both absolutely the same and totally different at the same time. So, of the three stanzas, the second stanza is the one that I identify with the most, because it was the time when she left the child, and I thought, what would you be experiencing that would make you leave the child on the ground? I mean, and go. So I'm just going to read you one stanza. Okay. Above the main room they hide, 6 days, 6 nights, pressed to the floorboards, cautious as the ash around them, below them, soldiers stomping to the blunt beat of perfect solutions. In the distance, explosions. Fighting intensifies, their panic mounts, no food or water, and Castria grows weak. Minutes pass, perhaps more. Bukhari is not sure when his breathing stops, why it stops, how to stop it, shaking, calling, caressing him. Nothing, pleading, still nothing. She lays his body on the disbelieving ground, does not scream, does not look back, but vows, always, always, always I will think of him, his downy crop, his coral mane, oblivious. And in writing that, it took the structure of a ballad that Michael Nyman and I worked with on this, called it our anti-ballad, because it was not the heroic, bloody narrative of the usual nationalist ballad, but it does have that kind of envoy at the end that's rather obscure. His downy crop is coral mean oblivious. It keeps being repeated throughout. And this is just a shot of the performance. Now, Michael Nyman, who had been a friend of mine and or is still and lives in London, had asked me to write something for him a long time ago, and I didn't want to do anything for musical theater, but when I did this exhibition, I said, well, this is perfect for you to do a score for the exhibition, the way he does the scores for Peter Greenaway's films and things. And in fact, that's the woman who sings in Peter Greenaway's films, Sarah Leonard. And so he did the string quartet for that. And it was performed at all openings. You walk around and read the libretto while the musicians are playing. And this is a shot in the Moderna Museum, but I just wanted to briefly refer you to a later piece that I did that you see there in the middle, which is based on the bomb shelters, the bomb shelters they made during the Second World War. There was the Anderson and the Morrison, and they were like kits that the British government set out for people to build from the absurdly do-it-yourself bomb shelter. But I bring that up because what happened in thinking about the case of Castria, and as you know, Sarajevo being the site of the beginning of the Second World War, and also the way that conflict went back to like the 14th century and the occupation of the Ottomans, right? And this kind of continual replay of what's kind of passed on from one generation traumatically to another. And actually, I was in a show in Germany in the late 70s, and at the artist party afterwards, there were English artists and British artists. And one of the German artists threw a glass of beer on a friend that I was with and said, "Here's for Dresden." And then he got a glass of beer and threw it back on him and said, "Here's for the Blitz." And I thought, neither one of these people was even born then. And so anyway, that was the kind of basis for making the bomb shelter, which, of course, again, you won't know, this is dug out. The real bomb shelter was 8 feet square, and it was 4 feet below ground, and 4 feet above ground. So the way I built it, I used a mirror. So when you look in, you kind of fall into the underground space. And the stories that are really from my generation, kind of remembering that post-war period are cut, laser cut on the surface of, or through the plastic. And I don't know the detail of the one that you see there, but very often what happens is they would say something like, "Well, my parents never talked about it." I mean, that more common than discussing it was a repression, was a silence. That was a significant thing. In one of these stories, he says, "Well, no, my mother never talked." Well, and he says, "Yeah, well, she did used to say that my uncle, what they were Jewish. They lived in Austria and they moved to England." That's the background. And she would say, "Well, your uncle went out one day and never came back. He was a dentist and I still have his tools." You know, so they were just the strangest things that would come back to memory. And so it's that kind of eccentric anecdotal narrative that was included there. Now, just moving on quickly. This is an installation view from Documenta 12. And you'll probably be asking yourself, "My God, where did that pink come from?" It was not me. It was the curator's decision. But it's interesting to think about, because when I first saw my space with this color in it, I felt sick. I had to go back to the hotel. I thought I was going to throw up. And so the logic, as the curator said, well, Hans Hock said to me, "You can't do that. You can't accept that." And then I thought about it. The curator's idea was that there would be this transmigration of form. That is, all of, each building and Documenta would be painted as it was originally when it was built, and that all the floor would be the same, so all the artists would be interconnected, and there'd be this kind of connection. And it was a very kind of postmodern approach, curatorial approach. And it did make me realize I was just a closet modernist wanting my white space, and I was ashamed. And I thought, as a feminist, I should go with this. All right. So I did. And what you see in the installation are the kind of four works in the project, Love Songs. And you have the multi-story house in the center, and you have this projection that I will briefly address, which is a reenactment or restaging with young women that I knew of the 1970 demonstration in New York that marked the 50th anniversary of the 19th Amendment. And in the placard, which is not very visible here, the original one was about the emancipation of women, which I thought was interesting because they invoked the language of the original suffragettes, of course, which takes me back to the earlier Historia piece that I made. But on my placard, I put a fragment from Sylvia Plath, "From Stone to Cloud," right? Because I felt in doing this project, it was a kind of love story between myself and another generation. It was a different way of a generational way of thinking about the mother-child relationship. And Sylvia Plath wrote the poem, I think, when she was having a child. And there was something, you know, so, well, Sylvia Plath is very dark, but this poem has some euphoria that is only, I think, explainable at certain kind of moments where you're in the company of other women or other people that you are experiencing something either culturally, socially, politically, personally, intensely, you know, at that moment. But in her, I think the bit of the poem that most impacted me was where she says, "Tree and stone glittered without shadow. My finger length grew lucid as glass. I started to bud like a March twig, an arm, a leg, an arm. So from stone to cloud, so I ascended, like a god in my soul shift, pure as a pane of ice. It's a gift. And that kind of, for me, encapsulated the intensity of the feeling. So then with the multi-story house, I took a lot of anecdotal material again, things women had said to me of my own generation and yours, and I made the house so that the stories from your generation are on the outside and mine on the inside, and you can't really see them both at the same time, but they're still connected. When you go into the space, it's illuminated by fluorescent light on the floor. I don't know if you can see this. So you're standing on the on glass on the light, if any of you saw it. It's very warm and kind of upbeat. For, and I thought, now, here we seem to be thinking about an event which is not the same kind of traumatic event that I was addressing in the Ballad of Kasia Rishapi, right? And it's something that I would call more of an epistemological event. And perhaps someone like Alain Badiou would speak of the event as something which is not planned, that kind of comes out of the blue, right? That is utterly transformative and kind of beside yourself, you remain faithful to it, or you try to remain faithful to it. It's that sort of thing. So inside, the kind of things that my generation would say are very indicative of this transformation. They say it's like a lightning bolt, or they say, you didn't speak for others, right? Or the high point was being in the company of other women and knowing we were part of something bigger than ourselves, or I remember thinking, wow, a women's group, a women's anything, or saying, everyone had a voice, yeah, you didn't speak for others. Or the high point for me was, okay, another one that says, the most transformative moment for me was when I discovered that I liked women and could even understand them. Right. So that kind of moment of discovery. On the outside, you can just imagine yourself looking through. Excuse my cough. But in the detail, on the outside, some of my favorite ones from the outside, the fragment of which you see perhaps right there, is my mother was a feminist, so yeah, I read Our Bodies, Ourselves when I was 8. And another one that says, well, I grew up dodging bullets in Angola, so the term feminist didn't mean much. Or in the 80s, everyone kept insisting feminism was over, but that made me more determined to find out what it was about. Or I didn't know I was a girl until I studied architecture and a professor said my work was cute. Then I started to dress down. Or second wave, third wave, missed everything, went through puberty in Saudi Arabia. There wasn't even a first wave yet. Or one of my favorite ones is this one. I've been a feminist since I was 5. We were living in Madrid then, during the last days of the dictatorship. My father was a Republican. He taught me about equality. Still, for Christmas, he gave my brother the big red French-Spanish dictionary, and I got a book on fairies. Or this one, living in Egypt as a girl, I knew something was wrong with the power structure, especially in church. But it didn't make sense until I went to university and found out about feminist art in a course called Fashion, Thesis, Fornication, and Fun. And the one that says, in Korea, I belong to a feminist reading group, and some women called it elitist. But when I moved to the U.S., everyone assumed I had a right to speak for the other. I mean, so it kind of goes on like that, but what you kind of notice immediately is how, with my generation, it's very homogeneous, in a sense. But it's just totally not like that for your generation. These were just people in my everyday life. I didn't seek them out. And they were from all these very different places with incredibly different ways in which feminism had an impact on them. So then I started to ask, well, you know, what is passed on from one generation to the next? Because obviously the demands, like that march in 1970 for abortion on demand, free childcare, those are the things didn't resonate at the moment. But I found in the restaging of the things that what seemed to matter and lasted, and I know in my own experience too that's true, was the pleasure being with other women. And in this work that's also in the installation you saw, the document installation, it's a sort of slapstick send-up of my participation in Miss World protest in 1971. And at the Miss, this is a restaging of what was the Women's Liberation Street Theater doing the flashing nickel routine outside the Albert Hall in 1971 when they were holding the Miss World pageant. And so they put the flashing lights on their nipples and crotch, and then they expose themselves to the police and the spectators. And of course, at that time, you have to remember it's like the high point of the situationist influence. So it wasn't conventional demonstrations. The gay liberation movement was handing out a trophy of large dildo with signs that said misguided, mislaid, misinformed. So there was the humor, the fun, this that was involved. And I did these time exposures here, three photographs, this one, and this one, and this one. And that probably says much more than I could in words about the moment. And then at Kazel, at Documenta, actually, and we did one at Orange County here, but I had 100 women that were just local and interested in feminism, because this is a happening, not an event, not a performance. The rules for happening is that you don't announce it, you use amateurs, you give them a list of instructions, and then they take it away, do what they can. So in the people didn't know, but at about 11 on the Edmund Baird Park, the 100 women started emerging from the hills of it. And they came down, they formed a long line, charged the audience, and this was the last cycle where they were improvising in a circle and catching a few German men that were saying, oh shit, in German. So I'm just going to end, because I think that it's going on too long, with just a little preview of what will be in some of the things that might be seen in the show if you go on Saturday, which is a large lint work. This one, which I did do for the Whitney Biennial in 2004. And this is Paris in 1968, right? And I've come back to that theme and come back to thinking about these very present images of the past, I would say ideologically loaded things that we live with, right? From the war to to the Arab Spring, which I think kind of marks the era that I'm claiming to be the ethnographer for. And against this, or not against this, but again, it's a linear process, but I'm able to make an image from it. And then these two, the obscure magazine, 7 days, I chose it because you can't even find it on the internet. It only lasted for 8 or 9 months. I worked on it. It was 1971 to 72. When you look kind of over the covers, I mean, the great aspiration was to have a left-wing magazine that looked like Life, and to have total parity for women, to have, you know, all the idealism of the moment, but very short-lived. And so what I wanted to do against these large, iconic images is just take the kind of slice of history, right, it's like a kind of cross-section, in which the events now may be obscure in their specificity, but the things they address, like the beginning of the prison movement, like the ethnic cleansing in Pakistan at the time, like unemployment, those themes continue. But I will leave you with a thought about what Hayden White calls the practical past, the way we live with these images and make use of them to figure out our daily lives.
Are you up for some questions, Mary?
Yes, I am.
Yeah. I never really thought of this until you presented just these pieces, but the getting back to that question of labor and how at one point everything, you made it so clear that it was so much about your own labor with your son, and then the mint pieces, I hadn't realized you actually did those yourself, which is really time-consuming labor.
Yeah.
But then they're very distinct to me from the 1990s, you know, from the interim project. So I thought maybe you could talk about the different relationship you had to labor in that work in the 90s, where a lot of people were getting work fabricated. So it seems consistent with that. But what that meant to you to do that, those pieces that were so pristine and kind of manufactured rather than the interim project.
Well, not very manufactured by today's standards.
No. Yeah, but the cast steel and you know, the Historia,
Well, like in Corpus, the screen printing is in my handwriting on the surface, right? And it's just a collage, the cutout of the clothing. The silk screen is just a silk screen on rolled steel. but I think, you know, rather than thinking about the, you know, labor so literally, I was trying to emphasize the aspect of duration, too, and the different forms that could take in the work. Duration in post-fire document that you were putting down an activity, real work that you did, like every hour and every day. In interim, you know, it's the there are 30 panels. It's takes time to go through it, right? And although there aren't any dates in it, the first-person narrative goes through stages, if you like, that I think of as marking marking time differently. But I think when I, maybe the most manufactured was Gloria Pottery that I didn't show, which was an etched aluminum. And that was intentional because I was trying to deal with this spectacle of war and I wanted to be kind of parodically horrible, you know, like an icy cold distant thing. But, you know, kind of coming back to thinking about the mother-child relationship in the context of ethnicity and trauma, the lint allowed me to do something that I could show it was time-based in the units. I just, in the studio, I head out a study for Documentation 2 the other day, and I had one of my, the new image lint panels up, right? And I realized how much like that notion of time and duration in 2, which is laid out like this and with dates, right? Was similar to the way those the grid was made up, the picture made up of these units, and you knew each one took so much time to produce, to reconstruct the whole thing. And then, of course, with these, I just love the way dates can mark duration and history at the same time. You know, you can do that thing. So the I think that more than, you know, the physical process that you might be thinking about, it's more the affective force of the material combined with its seriality or its kind of durational invocation.
So thank you for the great presentation. I have three questions. One is that do you think that it's really important for feminist artists to separate their body and representation of the female body in their work in order to have a more successful work? And then the second question is that, what is your opinion about the performance art, specifically feminist performers?
Just taking the first part of the question, first of all, I don't subscribe to feminist artists as a term. I know it will never catch on the way I want it to work, but I'd say it's art informed by feminism. And I think a lot of men are working in this way too. It needs to be acknowledged. It's art informed by feminism. So if your art is informed by feminism, then is it necessary always to contest the image, the woman's image? No, I tried to say in the talk, that was the time. It was like 1970, and it was just, huh, for the first time I realized that we were objectified, right? That's not, you know, you're much more sophisticated now. I mean, not that things have changed a lot in the field of how women are represented, but you know much more. And I think that's a difficulty for your generation. Whereas we were fumbling along, figuring out everything, changing the law, changing our lives, right? The whole finding the theory that could work. Now you know all that, but still the law hasn't changed, it goes back. Or the conditions, you're meant to think that you're freer, but in fact you're exploited more in some ways at times. So they're both, it's a different condition of existence for your work. So I would never say there's any formula that makes it more successful. It's successful because you have a project. You have a question that you address, right? And where does your question come from and what does that demand that you take on? And maybe it means that you use the body. Or maybe it involves nudity. It depends completely on the importance of the question. And that's why I was saying what you, not that everyone would think this way, but maybe in some other way than a discursive site that is connected to an oppositional movement, you might have an idea that links you very emotionally and theoretically to a argument, a position, or a question, and then that takes you in the direction that you need to make the work. Well, I don't know how to talk about it in general because it's very historically specific. But I,
the women artists that
Well, here in the 70s, there was a lot of performance work by women. And one problem I had with it then was that it was just so expected. Like, this was what women did. They did performance work. And, but there are many different tendencies within that field, and I think that they have now manifested themselves in a lot of different ways. There's theater, you know, and there's also still a tenet of theatrical performance, you know, like Ron Athey or something. There's the legacy of minimalism and the early work of the Von Raynard is kind of carried on by the groups like the two ex-students of mine, Brendan Gerard and Ryan Kelly, that did something at the Schindler House recently, you know, that, that follows that tendency. And certainly they're thinking in a feminist way about issues of sexuality in that piece and the family. And certainly you could say that even the theatrical works, you know, the Ron Athey's doing that. Because, I mean, there's so many ways that it's being used now. And each one kind of comes out of a different art historical tendency. So.
Citations of images, is there a kind of framework, are you operating within a similar framework? I'm interested in this.
Yeah, that is interesting. Well, I wouldn't call it utopian, but maybe someone else would. But I would call it critically engaged with documentary. That's how we started out. And once that critical engagement, say in Night Cleaners, just the use of the black spacing, what did that mean at the time? It was counter to expectation or what you might think of as utopian. There was no image. It was empty space. It was time to think. And I love empty space, time to think, no image, of course. And the thing is about the installation, I thought there's something so beautiful about the still image and installation because it gives you simultaneity in time, which the film can't do. Then it can, you can actually create empty space more easily. You can create this kind of possibility of reflection in that, which isn't necessarily a criticism of film, it's just a personal disposition. So why, perhaps thinking about, you know, as the new ethnography thought about, documenting any culture, meaning you can't separate it from the subjective investment. You know, once that shoe fell, then it was open to use a different kind of materiality to represent the document. Right? It didn't have to be just film and photograph, right? It could take other forms. And I think probably the work that I've just done, because it has so many historical sources, you might kind of think of it very much as critically engaged still with documentary.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's a good insight.
I've heard a lot about your grad critiques from friends, and I was just wondering if you could talk more about how you came to do the critiques in the way that you do. I just heard in passing. Mm-hmm. I was also wondering, too, if there's a way that you used to do critiques that were maybe
you changed
into the way that you do it now.
When I did a visiting artist at CalArts in 1987, and the students used to call Michael Asher's method the phallocentric method and mine the cone-centric method. and that was interesting because I do think it came out of feminism, or was informed by feminism. Because do you remember where it says you don't speak for, everyone has a voice and you don't speak for others, and there's a famous circle and, you know, ways of deconstructing hierarchy. And so the last thing that I thought you should do is put the artist who made the work in the hot seat to try to explain themselves in words. That, I mean, it's a useful thing because you get practice for the way the world is going to treat you. And it's always good to know that. But for me, I thought it was more important for the artist not to say anything than for everyone else to do the work of reading or viewing. And I mean, you've heard me talk so much already, I think you'll get completely OD'd if I try to explain the method to you. Don't you? But I have come to think of it now, more later, as actually the ethical approach to art. Because I realized working with art students for so many years that the hardest thing to do is to look at anyone else's work. Because, of course, you're caught up in making something yourself. When you're doing that, you are absolutely, a terrorist, or you are uncompromising. You are kind of, in order to do that, you've got to take a position, right, make a decision. Now, the thing is, though, when you look at something else, you have to give that up completely. And usually I found students don't want to. They keep projecting what they want in their work and saying, why didn't you do this? Right. Now, the thing that Agamben describes about in his work on ethics about a medial position is when you're in a medial position, you're not producing anything, you're not making anything, right? And you're just about open to receive something. And I think that's the state you need to get into when you look at it. That's ethically what you owe to the other. You know, that work is not you. That work does not give you what you want necessarily. It's there to confront, you give it the respect of the other. You say, I'm open to it, I'll see what it says. Now that brings me to the method, which is just a combination of lots of old-fashioned semiotics and structuralism with psychoanalysis thrown in for good measure. And that's that you, if you have the privilege of looking at an isolated object, mind you, that's not how it is in the world, because it's always in an exhibition. And that's a different course I give on system, exhibition and system. And it's not about what your reading is. I'm not a post-structuralist, but I don't believe it's about what you think. But I am interested in that, and when I do the course on psychoanalysis, you can think about art in that way, the way that Lacan does. But I still think there's an objective signifying reality to the visual text. And it's just as you read a book when you're a child and you don't know it at first and it's terrifying. I think that's how most people feel looking at art. They run to the label or they run to the artist for the explanation because they think they can't read it. But given it's, if it's, say we have a cultural thing in common. When you're looking at the work, it's like talking about the contemporary world. Careful, attentive looking is almost always close, if not exactly, a reproduction of the artist's decisions. Say you had, it's a painting, and if you use a round or flat, it makes a big difference. The round is a drawing technique. It's closely connected with the hand. It's going to be an indexical sign. It's going to privilege that more or less depending on the degree of modeling. If you leave impasto, then you know you're supposed to pay attention to the materiality. You're allowed to go there. In order to get realism, you've got to sacrifice color and texture, right? And you keep doing modeling, right? So if an artist has gone there, you know that. You can't say that they were trying to do the opposite. It's just like reading. And then when you get kind of onto the bigger systems of meaning, you know, what signs, iconic, symbolic, indexical, it's going to privilege one type of thing more than another, like lots of indexicality in mind. But look, there's minimal iconicity, but it's overwhelmed by processing. And what does the index mean? It means it's existentially bound to the thing that made it. What does iconicity mean? It means it draws you into resemblance. What is symbolic? I'm thinking of the symbolic here just as words, you know, and as relational, arbitrary signs, you know, things that don't look like what they're supposed to do. So if an artist uses things that are very diagrammatic, right, then it's almost like a word. You know, you've got nothing but line there. So that diagrammatic sign is going to take out the expressive quality, and it's almost always going to give you either a clue to an analytical read or to humor. I mean, it's just impossible to misconstrue these things if you then look at them in combination. So then the next thing you look at, it makes you feel, well, have I thought the right thing about this? Because it adds up. It adds up with, oh, I see, the kind of organization of the space in the work. Say it's an expressionist, it's informative, right? Or say it's a very symmetrical composition. Picasso was great at this, kind of disguising something that was heavily symmetrical, but if you use symmetry, you're going to invoke a kind of more ideological, more settled, more resolved read, then you might kind of cut against it. I mean, so anyway, to make the very, very long method takes hours to do this with a single work, you would end up thinking about, excuse me, visual rhetoric, and then privileging, you know, the terms like metaphor and metonymy. Because any work, even if it's using a system of displacement or emphasizing a metonymic axis, at some point the aha effect's going to take place, which is the moment of metaphor, which is substituting a whole different system of meaning here. And if that, you know, there are different ways that you can think about that when you get to that point, because that's a crucial point of telling you when to stop. Because when the artist wants you to stop, you know, do they not want this to close down? You know, your reading should lead you to say, nope, this work doesn't talk about sexuality, it doesn't do this, doesn't do this. Nope. And it will tell you, because very often a strategy, an open-ended strategy, a serial strategy, is one that tries to get you to defer that process of ending. Whereas something that has humor, as we're talking about, is a very quick pleasure. It's like Bart says, there are two different pleasures. One that's, you know, it's fast, it's like the joke. And the other is difficult, he says. And it leaves you not quite sure, but it's still pleasurable. Most people who have been through this, you've been through this, right? It does work, doesn't it?
Yes.
And it's like once you learn it, anybody can kind of do it.
Yeah.
So it's not a mystery.
I
I think in some ways, like, you can almost glean what it would be if you read Exhibition and Systems. So there's the procedure, and then you can, one can apply that procedure to works. In reviewing modernist, if you read all of reviewing modernist history within that exhibition system, I think you give a little bit of the technique in there.
Yeah, I think so. I'm sorry for the very, very long answer, but that's a...
But it's, I remember, like, it's shocking in the beginning, because it comes out of, we're not used to reading art in that way.
Right.
Yeah. I'm curious how the text is applied or to the linked pieces and how those forms are made. You're open to sharing about that.
They're not applied, but I realize that, you know, forms of printing, those sort of processes are there in all of the work. You know, the postpartum document number 6 I showed you with the slates, and I made a play tub out of kitchen foil, and then I put it in the typewriter to do the typing, and then I kind of copied the other letters on the thing, and then I cast it with slate filler and resin onto real slate and dusted it up like Rosetta Stone. So it's kind of a printing process. The text came out in, you know, in intaglio. And with the lint, too, it's the vinyl is on the screen. You know, nothing is tampered with later. You put it on the screen, the lint goes through, you turn the lint out in the cart, and it comes out like an intaglio. Right? It's very low relief, very low relief.
I have two questions. The first I've always wondered about is how many dryers do you have?
Just one, and I just live in terror that it will break.
And the second is
because there aren't any, you know, everything changes in the in the technical world. They don't make the same screens, the same anything, right? And as you know, if you go back, you try to get like the same glue, the same paint, the same. Mounting board, I mean, it's always changing, so that...
The second one I had is, as the privilege of gays just seem to endure in spite of the fact that we're now aware of objectification, what do you feel are the strategies then that are best used to kind of talk about that now?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's... But you have to answer. I couldn't be prescriptive about that.
Okay. Thank you so much.